only way out of any struggle in life was education alone. That experience from the early years ignited in me a desire to create something of value in those people who were not blessed to receive the kind of education that gives the strength to dream. My journey with LeapForWord started in 2006 after volunteering for 5 years as a mathematics teacher in an evening school, in institutions for kids and NGO. Freshly out of a business school, me and a few of my batchmates started deliberating on one question. What is that one thing, if when solved, could have a direct positive impact on employability? 2 years of B-school training, and we had become fairly good at ideation, and those discussions led me to the mission of the organization, which was about solving the problem of English illiteracy in the country. But neither I nor anyone else on the team had any clue how to go about it. So we researched the internet, spoke to experts, curated content from popular books, and then begged for a chance to teach. Went to colleges, evening colleges, night schools, wherever, but we didn't get a chance. With nothing much happening, despair seemed to be setting in. But I have had a thing going my way all my life. When things don't seem to move at all of a sudden from somewhere, a solution happens. My earliest memory of this sudden appearance of solution is from my early days. When we were growing, money was hard to come by. Parents struggled really hard to make ends meet. And if there was ever a need for money, we couldn't ask because they couldn't give. Exactly at that time, the raddi at my home would become big enough to be sold. My father is an avid newspaper reader, and we would collect a lot of raddi. And he had offered me and my brother to keep the proceeds from the sale of raddi to us. So in the earliest years, it was raddi that funded the small desires and wants. To come back, with life at the chosen mission not going too far, raddi happened. One of the various meetings with the colleges begging for a chance to teach, finally one went through. St. Xavier's Evening College allowed us a chance to start working, and thus started LeapForWord for the first time with a batch of 27 students in their night college. During the weekdays, I would attend a job. In the evenings, I would create content. And on weekends, we would go and teach. Everything that didn't work during the weekend classes would go in for repairs. And again, the next weekend, a new set of content would be tried out. While it appeared that everything was going fine, that started happening what happens to most 26 years old with a job: marriage. Not for me, but for people with me. Marriage became the first cause of casualties at LeapForWord. Team size started dwindling because people now had better things to do on the weekend. But I wasn't so lucky, so I continued with the work. The first batch at Xavier's resulted into two more, got us an entry into BMC schools, and led me to Shirpur, a tribal place in District Dhule in state of Maharashtra, which invariably became my real training ground. The 3 years between 2006 to 2009, especially the stays in the villages amongst the people that I wanted to work with, fanned that tiny desire in me into a fairly strong flame. I quit my job to work full-time for LeapForWord. With no job in hand, no place to work from and to make matters worse, an extremely angry father at home. A coffee shop outside the other railway station became my place to work from. So here I was, educated, unemployed, teaching BMC school students every morning and spending every evening at this coffee shop trying to occupy a table for 4 hours by ordering as little as I could. Work had begun, there was focus, and there was coffee in the evening to Excel sheet the future. But then there was no money to grow. From the 3 years of my post-MBA job, I had saved some money for personal sustenance, but the mission had none. In the preceding years, all the work that we did was funded from my salary, but I now wouldn't have a salary. But guess what? Life gave me what it always gave, Raddi. And so happened Edelgive to me. Edelgive became LeapForWord's first institutional donor, and suddenly I had wings. To top it up, two extremely dedicated volunteers and friends agreed to join me on the journey full time, although on a temporary basis, and I was happy to have them come by. In those 2 years, we did a lot of work. We increased our work in BMC, expanded our footprint in Shirpur, and did some amazingly creative content development. But I had made a choice not to ever draw salary from this job, but to figure out an alternative way to fend for myself. But all the available time was spent only on mission work, and so the obvious happened. I ran out of money. On 1st January 2011, I was penniless, nothing in the pocket, nothing in the bank. At that moment, reality had dawned on me, and I knew it was time for a rethink. I decided to step back a bit. I returned Edelgive's check of renewed donation, returned Unlimited India's fellowship stipend, concluded the one ongoing project in BMC, though I continued my weekends, going to Shirpur over the weekends. The 5 years between 2006 and 2011 had breezed by, leaving very little time for introspection. So here I was, no job, no money, not knowing where all this was going, and worse still, an even angrier father at home. So then life gave me what it always did, Raddi. I found myself in the form of a job in an extraordinary consulting firm run by a man called Srinivas Venkatram, the man to whom I surrendered, not as my boss, but as my guru. And I learned. Mental blocks started vanishing, focus started coming back, and I had a stride in my step. I left home to stay close to office. I worked after office hours, which were now extended due to reduced travel, on going deeper into content. I worked for Srinivas for 30 months. I had rehabilitated and had made a vow that I would never again come close to penury ever again. And I was ready to what I felt was my 2.0 at LeapForWord. And thus, I restarted my journey and I took SV's leave. Though the mind was clear, but I most certainly needed some really, really good help. So life gives me Raddi again. I get married. My wife gives me the freedom to do whatever I want to do, while she offers to run the house. So I was back. I was back in the game. Reached out to the two institutions that had shaped us, Xavier's and Edelgive. Told them the truth, and they helped. Xavier's gave me a paid teaching assignment in a B school and a staff room to work from, while Edelgive continued from where it had left in terms of support, and this time around more generously. Work continued, and sometime in 2013, the first major breakthrough happened. The translation algorithm, which could convert English into Sanskrit and vice versa with an extremely high degree of accuracy, was tested and was ready to go live. The algorithm now is the backbone of LeapForWord's flagship program. Good times continued. I became a father. Soon later, I got the Ashoka Fellowship. And later, we won a contest whose prize money was to be exclusively used for recruiting a team. On 1st January 2015, LeapForWord's first professional employee was recruited. Since then, in the past 5 years, a lot has happened. We have now become a 38 people team. LeapForWord's English literacy program is now available in 3 languages. What started out from 1 classroom has now scaled to 51 districts. Our techniques are now available in the Balbharti textbook of Maharashtra State Government. And for the first time this year, thanks to technology, 100,000 plus teachers explored our content in a span. Thank you. In a span of just 12 weeks. Challenges continue to remain, just that their forms have changed. Our belief, however, that the mission of eliminating English illiteracy will be achieved continues to grow stronger every year. This is my 19th year in the sector and the 13th at LeapForWord. I have had many costs to bear, but never a price to pay. That I continue to keep hope is the finest status quo. The speakers before me have very aptly signified the one in their life story. My one, as you have all heard, is Raddi. Dictionary meaning of which is trash. But for me, it has always symbolized a solution. It has come in my life at the most critical junctures, in various forms, and bailed me out. These various forms, to me, are manifestations of just one, my God. LeapForWord has always been God's work for me. There is a contract that exists between me and my God through this work. As long as I stay true to the purpose, do not succumb to temptations, and keep the faith, work will continue and see itself to fruition. Raddi will keep happening. I would like to thank Edelgiv, Vidya ma'am, and Nagma for being there always. I sign off from this opportunity to speak before you with a quote that I keep hearing within. It reads, Karya Siddhis Nenyas Shri Samarthahe, meaning God is willing. Thank you.
Can you take us to the algorithm you've been speaking of? Because I think it'll be very useful for people to know what you've been working on for so long.
Sure. So I'll speak as you see the video. So English that we speak, any sentence essentially comprises 3 parts. One is the speaker or the doer. Second is the action word. And the third is the act. So the flow of language, that is English, is the doer plus the act plus the action word, then follows the act. So here it is, I eat a small piece of cake every day. So I am the doer, it is the action word, and a small piece of cake every day is the act. Languages that originate from Sanskrit have this order in a different manner. Sanskrit works as doer comes first, the act comes second, and it ends with the action word. So if you are able
to codify this, my spoken English becomes comprehensible. So essentially 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 up to N in a Sanskrit language or language that originates from Sanskrit will be 1, N, N minus 1, N minus 2, all the way going up to 2. So what you see is a Google Translate. So I'm not comparing myself with Google, just that we look at it from a language perspective, how languages differ, and hence our accuracy rate is fairly high. We're not a technology company. We've stared at languages for so long that we realize there's a pattern in which languages differ. So fundamentally, the flow is in the opposite direction. And if you're able to do it, you're able to create a code. Anything that can be codified becomes linear. Languages essentially are non-linear. If you can bring a code to it, becomes a linear. Anything that is linear is maths. And anything that is maths can be taught into steps. And hence, English could be taught into steps. From alphabets to reading, from reading to comprehension, and you keep increasing its complexity.
I'd love to know a little about the students and what has been the impact of LeapForWord.
So our primary work is with the government school teachers. So we are saying any person who has a job of teaching English but cannot do so effectively because he or she cannot speak English is my target audience. So we do not by choice work in classrooms or communities where there is exposure to English. When the exposure is absent, language learning is impossible. In only such contexts we choose to work, which essentially is most regional language government schools across the country. So the idea is that teachers are given techniques and they use these techniques to build very specific capabilities in the children. So any teacher who chooses to run the program in his or her classroom using these techniques is able to see very specific progress. For example, in a span of 40 to 60 hours, if a child knows only the alphabet and nothing more, the child is able to read and spell single syllable words in a span of 40 to 60 hours. The child is slightly older from that level to a stage where the child could read as good as you and I read, it takes another 40 to 60 hours. So we have seen a lot of progress in extremely rural areas where kids have developed capabilities of reading and spelling, and suddenly a lot of kids from our communities are now appearing for public examinations, clearing them and getting into semi-English or English medium schools.
Is there any way your model could reach out to older people? Because, you know, there are a lot of youth in villages that are extremely capable but then can't communicate in English. And they're very intimidated by the language or any foreign language, you know, any language out other than theirs. So is there a mechanism that you could reach out to them with?
The older youth?
Yeah.
The older. So I'll kind of give a backdrop and Nagma will concur. I have a notoriety and a popular for that in the Edelgive house is that I would come with a new product every month. And so Edelgive at one point in time gave me a mentor. And I continue to work with that mentor. That mentor asked me one question, what are you willing to let go of and continue with only one? So at one point in time, we had a program for kids, program for youth. We had a certification exam on lines of IELTS. But in the interest of focus, we chose to work with on the kids program. So we do have a youth program that we are reviving, working pilots. And the idea is to make it live before the commencement of the next academic year. And this could work in any language. If English can be translated into Sanskrit, any two languages could be translated into each other. So we don't have it now, but it's on the agenda to get it out before June next year.